Hi, I'm Hitesh, Senior Program Manager for Microsoft System Center. It is great to see you again in the deep dive session on System Center 2019. In the previous session, I gave you an overview of what's new in System Center 2019. In this session, we'll dwell a bit deep into some of the new features of the 2019 release and learn how to leverage them for your data center management. Let us start with SCOM 2019. As you would have seen earlier, we have made an array of announcements in SCOM 2019. I'll be discussing some of these as we move forward in the session. All of these are well documented in the product documentation. Please feel free to refer it. Let me begin by telling you about the enhancements that we have made in the notifications and subscription space in SCOM. We have made life easier for you by improving the criteria builder and the email notification experience. The criteria builder has been made more powerful. It is used to specify a set of conditions. When these conditions are met, they lead to a notification for an alert. This helps in ensuring that you receive notifications for the alerts which matter the most to you. The criteria builder provides you with the ability to exclude objects, use logical and/or groupings, and use regular expressions to build a complex yet efficient criteria. Let me quickly show you the improvements that we have made in the criteria builder. Let's head out to the SCOM console and try to create a new subscription. I'll give it a name. Now we are not defining the scope at this point in time. This is an additional and an optional step in defining a criteria for your email notifications or the alert notifications. This is the new criteria builder. Let us start creating a sample criteria here. So suppose if I want to be notified if an alert instance name does not contain the value test in it, then I need a notification to be triggered to me. As you see, does not contain is a new operator. We have added several such operators in the new criteria builder, which will help you create a complex and an efficient criteria. As you can see, we can use more OR groupings here. I have already created a sample criteria in the interest of time, which I'm just going to show you. Now you see how complex and efficient criteria you can create using the new criteria builder. Now, if you click on the formula button right out there, you can also see the formula that comes out of this complex and efficient criteria that we have just created here. Now, since we know about the improved criteria builder, let us also learn about the improvements that we have made with respect to the email notifications. Email remains the most natural and primary medium to notify the user of a new alert. We have made the email notifications experience much better by adding the capability to create and send HTML formatted email notifications. These notifications not only look good aesthetically, but also deliver great value to the users. It provides them with links in the email itself to view the drill down pages of the alert, alert source, and the corresponding rule or monitor which generated this alert. Here are some resources if you want to know more about the email notifications feature. Web consoles have become an integral part of any enterprise software. We have made significant investments in making the SCOM web console more user-friendly and efficient. Today, the SCOM web console and dashboards can be accessed from a variety of web browsers. Users can extend the dashboards by using the SCOM REST APIs, and troubleshooting was never this easy with the drill-down dashboards. In the earlier version of SCOM, if you close the alert while the object is in a warning, critical, or unhealthy state, the problem remained unsolved and no further alerts were generated unless the health state for the monitor had also been reset, which again was a manual task. This behavior often led to closure of critical alerts without resolving the underlying problem. SCOM 2019 brings a solution to this problem. Now, an alert which has been generated by a monitor cannot be closed unless the health state of the corresponding monitor is healthy. This ensures that the machine is not rendered unmonitored. Let me quickly walk you through this new behavior. Let us head to the SCOM web console. We have an active alerts dashboard, which is a new dashboard that we are shipping with SCOM 2019. As you can see, we have many alerts here. And now, let us see the alerts which are generated by the monitor. We have two alerts here, which are generated by monitors. You can see the true flag there in the monitor column. Let us select one of these and try closing it. We'll give it some comment. Let us click on save now and see what happens. We get an error prompt that the selected alert cannot be closed as the monitor which has generated this alert is still unhealthy. Now, what do you do about this? So now, what we have further made some enhancement here, and we have added an alert closure failure dashboard to it. What does it do? The alert closure failure dashboard lists down such alerts for which an attempt was made to close these alerts, but they were unsuccessful. So the alert cannot be closed. So this is more like a place where you can go and see what all alerts were not closed. Now, if you want to close this alert, just click on the reset health button and you see that the alert is gone. It is closed, which is a healthy behavior, which we would like all the customers to follow as a best practice. Let's move on. Updates and recommendations for third-party Linux workloads. This feature now allows you to have updates and recommendations for the Linux management packs as well as for the third-party management packs like WebLogic and Wildfly and things like that. It brings in parity with the Windows side of workloads in the Linux world now. Also, we have added one more capability. Here, whenever you will see that there is an update to an already existing management pack, or say a new management pack is needed, you can right-click right on the console and see what machine is this workload running on, so that you can do quick troubleshooting and take quick decisions. Moving on, let's discuss a bit about the Linux log file monitoring capability that's there in SCOM 2019. SCOM now has enhanced log file monitoring capabilities for Linux servers by using the newest version of the agent that uses Fluentd. Fluentd is an open source data collection software. With Fluentd integration, you can leverage open source plugins to read and filter data from a wide list of data sources. Once the data is collected, Fluentd creates an event on the basis of a pattern match. This event is pushed to the SCOM management server, where the rules and monitors in a custom management pack generate alerts on these events. As we had seen in the earlier sessions, the major driver for Virtual Machine Manager is the growth of hyperconverged infrastructure adoption and hybrid deployment scenarios. We have made investments in several areas in VMM, and I'll be taking you through some of them in this session. On the management front, one of the commonly used functionalities that is available in VMM is managing updates for the host and clusters in the data center. Ideally, administrators would want to manage updates of VMs as well as use VMM as a single management pane. However, this capability was not available in prior releases of VMM. Now, Azure Update Management provides the ability to patch and update not just your VMs running in Azure, but your on-premises VMs as well. VMM 2019 supports management of updates of Windows OS VMs using VMM by integrating VMM with Azure Automation Service. This will help users to manage their VM updates on both on-premises and Azure VMs. Let me walk you through a quick demo of the same. In VMM 2019, we have created a profile, which is a new profile known as Azure Profiles. Let us try to create an Azure profile. Here you see that in the Azure profile, we provide a subscription ID of the Azure Update Management. And then we also add the Azure Automation account details here and the workspace key. Let's click OK. Now, what we will do is that we will try to create a new VM template, and in the extensions, we will enable Azure Update Management. Here, we are giving the same Azure profile that we had created earlier. Now, what you will see that any of the VMs which are deployed using this VM template will hash Azure update management info down there. If you click on the update status, it will take you to Azure portal. Here, if you click on update management, and now you see the compliance status of these VMs, which were deployed using the VM templates, which used Azure profiles. So you can see both the platforms, you can see non-Azure and Azure IaaS VMs as well. And you can see the compliance status, you can update these VMs, manage upgrades, also get the status of the upgrades. Let us discuss about VM admin role in VMM 2019. The new RBAC role in VMM has been introduced to cater to the requirement for a user persona that is responsible for troubleshooting or providing IT help desk services. This persona will need permissions to make changes on VMs while having an insight of the fabric condition. However, it is not preferred for this user to make changes to the fabric. The current RBAC in VMM does not support this persona. Users can either have too many or not enough permissions to perform help desk operations. The new VM admin role bridges this gap. There is no change in the process of creating a VM admin role. So let me just quickly take you through a demo and how this thing works out. Let's see. Let us head to the VMM console and try to create a new user role. We call this role a VM admin demo, and we can add a description, but let's skip it for this demo. Here in the profile, you will see a new profile called Virtual Machine Administrator. This was not available in the earlier versions of VMM. Let's go on next and try to create this role. As you can see in the description below, it clearly tells you that this persona can view all the fabric elements within their assigned scope. If we want, we can add members or user accounts to this role. Here, let us select the scope of this. So we'll select MVP Demo Cloud, and we will also select Storage Do in this one. Let's move forward. Here, we need to provide some permissions to this persona so as to what all functions this role can do and what all this persona cannot do. So we will select a few of those, like start, stop, shutdown, save, migrating a virtual machine, these things. And let us try to complete this wizard. Moving on, let's click on next. Here we have the option to add a library server. We have skipped this for the while. Now, as we see, the VM admin demo is now created. I am logged in as this persona, which is the VM admin demo. You can see this on the bar above. As you can see, the moment we select MVP Demo Cloud and we select a VM which is there, so we are able to see some actions that this role can perform. However, we see that in the Storage Do account, we are able to access the Storage Do because we had selected that. But the For Cloud also, we are able to access, even though that was not in the scope. Now you see that for each of these VMs, we have all those permissions that we had selected earlier while defining the scope for this role, like migrating a virtual machine, saving the state, reset, power off, etc. However, we don't have the other roles which we did not select. Now, once you click on the fabric and a VM inside the host, we will not see all these options because we want this user to still have the access to the fabric but not take any actions on it. And as you can see, this role is able to access all the fabric even though For Cloud was not in the scope. Let us move to Data Protection Manager. Again, a quick overview of what's new in DPM. So in DPM, we have made significant performance improvements to the backup time. DPM supports newer workloads of Windows SQL, SharePoint, and Exchange. And if you use VMware to host your workloads, we are now supporting backing up your VMware workloads to tape storage for long-term protection and we also backup these workloads in parallel for faster backups. You will also be able to take advantage of rich analytics and monitoring capabilities in Azure to monitor your DPM servers. In the previous session, we had a deeper look at performance improvements that were made in DPM 2019 and saw a demo on how you can register your DPM server with Azure for long-term protection. In this session, let us look at how you can use Azure Log Analytics to monitor your DPM at scale. By pushing DPM diagnostics data to Log Analytics, you can take advantage of the rich analytics capability of Azure. Let us head to the Recovery Services Vault and hit Backup Reports. Here, we need to link the diagnostic settings in order to allow the Azure backup to push the DPM reports into Azure Log Analytics. Let us give this a name. Let us select Send to Log Analytics and select Azure Backup Report. Here, I'm connecting to an already existing Microsoft Azure subscription and an already existing Log Analytics workspace in it. We select the Azure Backup Report as the log that we want to send to Log Analytics, and we save this. Now, as we see, this is an existing Azure backup monitoring solution that is already available there. Here, you can see that we have the backup jobs which are completed and which are failed. So we are able to see the status of those. And in other words, we are able to monitor those. Moving forward, we will also see the alert distribution. So here we see that a 5 of total alerts are from the on-premise backup. Out of this, 3 are critical and 2 are in the warning stage. We also see the last known protection status. So all the 4 are actively protected, and we can also see how much of the space is consumed in the cloud. I hope the System Center deep dive session was useful to you. I am leaving a few resource links below that will help you get started with System Center 2019, and be sure to check them out. Thanks for joining us for this session and for tuning in to Windows Server Summit 2019.